Thames Television went on the air on July the 30th, 1968. To celebrate our birthday, Edward Woodward now looks back on 21 years of television history.
Thank you very much. It is so nice to be back. Welcome to the birthday show, a celebration of 21 years of laughter from Thames Television, with one of the most glittering casts ever assembled for one show. Now, for the next 90 minutes, it is going to be my happy task to take you back through the funniest moments from those shows of those years. And this is where it all happened, right here, here in Teddington Studios. When you are compiling a show like this, who do you open with? There is really only one contender, the dearly loved Tommy Cooper.
Now, I want you to imagine the scene. It's a prisoner of war camp outside a village called Sisser Slush. Berlin. At the time, it's 1940, or 2008. And the leader of the escape committee is Brigadier Fontagu Smythe. And he's been sent for by that brutal cop commandant, Fritz von Spanheim. So, Brigadier, you're a wondering why I sent for you? No? Well, last night, 370 prisoners escaped from the camp. How does you account for this? You left the front gate open. Lies, oh lies! They smuggled themselves out in the laundry baskets. How do you find that out? You'll never see him again, I'll tell you that. I know that laundry. Here is the list. Two vests, four shirts, and 370 prisoners. And when they are caught, they will be shot. Oh, no, they won't. Yes, they will. Oh, no, they won't. Yes, they will. And when they are caught, everyone will be shot one by one. Because... Why are you imitating me?
I promise you, there will be more of that great man later. Now, this obviously is a makeup table. This is where actors spend an awful lot of their time. And this is the where the girls get to work on us, if you'll pardon the expression. Some of us need more work than others. I myself am now becoming a bit of a polyfiller man. During the past 21 years, one man in particular employed makeup to add a brilliant dimension to the art of impersonation. Here, aided by Suzanne Danielle as his princess, interviewed by Selena Scott, is the Prince of Wales, a.k.a. Mike Yarwood.
Your Royal Highnesses, thank you very much for agreeing to talk to us. You know, it's not often one gets the chance to talk to someone quite so famous.
We were just saying the same thing, weren't we, Charles?
Yeah, absolutely.
This year has, of course, been a very happy and memorable one for you both with the birth of your baby son. Has it been a difficult transition to adapt to a new role as a parent?
Yes, I find it absolutely astonishing how much one has to learn when one becomes a father. I mean, take the art of nappy folding. Before, I always thought that one just licked the corner and stuck it down.
And how is young Prince William developing? Is he showing any signs yet of displaying his own character?
Oh, yes, he's picking up all the family mannerisms. Already he's learned to crawl with one hand behind his back.
He does sound just enormous fun.
Well, there's never a dull moment when he's around. Sometimes, after Charles has finished bathing him, I tickle him under the chin, and he rolls round on his back, making a silly gurgling noise. And sometimes I do the same to William.
I must say, he is a lovely baby.
Thank you very much.
He's got his mother's eyes, his grandmother's nose, and I think his auntie's mouth.
Yes. When you get to the ears, they're mine.
I gather you're rather fond of Prince William's bath times.
Oh, yes. Well, I think Charles is a bit overprotective towards our son at times.
I'm not overprotective, really.
Well, why do you make him wear a parachute when he sits in his high chair?
Have you ever thought of having him painted?
No, we like him the colour he is.
May I move on to something else?
Well, you can come and sit over here if you like.
I don't mean that. I mean, Mom, can I ask you what you're hoping Prince Charles is going to give you this Christmas?
Well, I really don't know. But last year he gave me something very beautiful.
May I ask what that was?
Cornwall.
Of course, being a typical woman, she took it back and changed it for Devon.
Well, finally, Your Royal Highnesses, may I say how absolutely delightful it's been to talk to you, and on behalf of all the viewers, may I wish you both a very happy Christmas.
Thank you very much. Perhaps you'd like to join us for a festive drink. You've got a marvellous new cocktail shaker.
No, we haven't. It's his day off.
I have been a very lucky man. I have known and worked with most of the stars in tonight's show. I have literally worked alongside them, because while they'd be doing their shows in one studio, usually this very studio here, I would be possibly next door doing a series I used to do some years ago called Callum. And I made it my point to see them and meet them whenever I could. Coming to work was a pleasure, especially if it meant sharing a table in the canteen with any one of these gentlemen, Frankie Howard, Ken Dodd, and the then up-and-coming Ton O'Connor.
No, the thing is, ladies and gentlemen, adverts. The thing is that I don't like to advertise products myself unless the image, you see, unless the product itself is in keeping with my image. I mean, for instance, that one I did for the toilet roll people. Well, that was, I'm waiting to commence. That what I thought was very tasteful. It was because it was done, you know, and unfortunately it was never shown because the firm went down the pan. How dare you? But the thing is, I have actually done a number of, auditions you would call them for adverts because, you know that one about the man in black who jumps onto a train and runs along the top holding a box of chocolates? Originally, that was me, you see. Unfortunately, there was one thing that everyone concerned had overlooked, namely the tunnel. And when I came out of hospital, they had given the part to somebody else. That's what annoyed me. And of course, it's that, No, I'm glad you asked, because I was the man who used to go swinging through the jungle, you see, wait a minute, holding on to a sack full of peanuts. And oh, I did look good, honestly, standing up there, dressed in my leopard skin hot pants. I was a picture of of primitive magnificence. Oh, it was a tragedy, though. It was a tragedy because I was... Oh, no. I was swinging through the trees, holding on to me nuts. I'm waiting to commence. And snap! So I looked and I thought, hello, a branch has gone. I looked down, no, it was my braces. I don't know if any of you have tried swinging on a rope and trying to pull up your pants at the same time. Well, let me enlighten you, it cannot be done. Oh, I fell, that poor crocodile. But you know, well, you see, no, he expected me to tread on him, not fall on him. Oh, I did damage him. You can still see the dent in the handbag, it is a shame.
Now, what do you say? How do you become a comic? Well, first of all, you have to have your potential spotted. You can always get it off with Turks. And then you go out and buy yourself a baggy check suit and a big red nose. Of course, unless, of course, you like me and you've already got them. These are all jokes, you know. The first thing you have to do is develop a catchphrase. Catchphrase like, can you hear me, mother? Shut that door. Mind that cat. Where's the sideboard? Or, my new catchphrase is Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. You see, in 12 months' time, everybody will be saying it. This, auto-suggestion. That's the things like auto-suggestion and confidence. When you go home tonight, stand in front of the bedroom mirror and say to yourself, I'm getting better and better. I'm getting better and better. And the wife will sit up in bed and say, hey, I'm bragging again. Be optimistic. Be like the man. Be like the man who said, I can and I will. And he did. He got 3 months for it. I mean... Thank you, sir. Keep it up. It's you and me against that. I mean, what do different countries find funny? Well, the Russians are very funny. In Russia, every other word ends in off. That's why you don't see many Russian comedians. The Germans like to march up and down like this, you see? Yeah. You have to laugh. If you don't, they'll shoot you. Yes. I'll do anything for laugh, honestly. I'll do anything for laugh. I once took all my clothes off at a party and I slid down the banisters yodeling at the top of my voice. I didn't mean to yodel. I mean, the banister had all those little brass studs on it. Laughter. Laughter is what... I paid for two, you know, there should be another one, isn't there?
Your holiday hotel. You're signing in. Hello, senor. Is this your wife?
Come on, pal. You don't think I'd live in cinema there, do you?
You want to go to the bar. Of course you do. Not to drink, good heavens, no. Only to practice your Spanish. Because we're brilliant at Spanish, our lads, aren't we? You've heard him in Spain.
You all. Bringo to me all.
To all. Coco culo.
His wife says, oh God, Harry, aren't you good? And he says, I was here in the war, you know.
The big problem with wives on holiday is that they get you there, then they want you running about. You know, come on with the kids on the beach. If you were half a man, you'd take them to the circus.
As half a man, I'd be in the circus.
Well, I remember David Nixon, whose tricks were pure magic, and who had a wonderful, warm way of working with members of his audience. The clip you are about to see illustrates perfectly what I mean. We join David in mid-trick. His volunteer, also called David, has supplied the essential pound note.
David, now this is absolutely on the level, isn't it? There is your note, your signature. Never touched it before in my life, that's for real. Now, will you take one of these envelopes out, please? Just one envelope. Look inside, make sure that it's empty. And then if you'll fold your pound note in half, put it in the envelope. Have you done that?
Yes.
And then if you don't mind sticking the flap down, David, because I don't care for the taste, they're rather... they're second hand, I'm awfully sorry. And just to make sure, once again, would you sign your initials... Would you like to use this pen? Just sign your initials over the flap so that you'll know your envelope again, or so that you'll know it again, and there's no possible chance of my playing any dirty, dishonest, deceitful magician's tricks. There it is, pound note signed, envelope signed, right? Now, I have to just warm your pound note up a bit to make it more flexible, you see. And the idea is that I run the lighter along like this, and that gets it kind of malleable, and you're looking worried. Let me give you a little security here. This stick of rock that David gave me, he said it had got Teddington right through the middle, but, oh, yes, it's not true, actually. It's got Teddington at that end, but this end it's got not Gnedet. Anyway, David, sir, this stick of rock is yours entirely if anything goes wrong and you don't get your pound note back. Now, we'll warm it up again. That's lovely. Now, we only warm it. It doesn't actually burst. Oh, I'm sorry. Have you ever done this before?
No.
Neither have I. slightly embarrassing. What can I say when I've said I'm sorry? I'm sure, which is the back way out? No, it shouldn't have gone that far. David, I did promise you the stick of rock, and I'm a man of my word. Will you examine that stick of rock? Feel the weight of it, look at it. Is it solid?
It is.
Absolutely solid. Teddington running right the way through the middle of it. Well, as far as you can see. Solid in the middle?
Yes.
Solid rock. A hammer? Let me show you that my hands are quite empty. I will hold the rock for you like that over this plate. Nothing in my hands. Just tap it gently in the middle. Oh, let's skim it a bit. Let's take some of this cellophane off and make it easier. Just give it a gentle tap at first, somewhere. Let's peel that off. Somewhere near the middle. And a little bit nearer the middle, that's a bit that way about it. That's it. Tap it. Beautiful. Cracked it. Once again, try another one about there. Give it another. Oh, boy. How long have you got? Hit it again, David. It's still beating. Oh! Look at that. What is it? Thank heavens for that. That is your pound note. M09M. Check the number. 140683.
You know what? I would love to know how he did that. Eric Sykes. One of those rare, gifted souls who is just as funny sitting in a typewriter writing comedy as he would be if he were here now performing it. Remember the film called The Plank? Well, the extract we are about to see is from the sequel, a sort of Plank 2. It's called It's Your Move, and it also starred just about every well-known British comic actor and actress that you can think of. Now, we follow that up with a glimpse of Eric Sykes, the performer, in a sort of concert with guitarist John Williams. But first, It's Your Move.
Ha ha ha!
plate of ice cream from Albanitz, okay? Right. Albanitz, I got it right.
Yes.
I thought it was fixed, Banitz. Okay, will you start, John?
I'll start it, thanks. Ready?
In the 60s, when Thames Television was just a twinkle in its shareholders' eyes, it was every rock and roller's dream to be an all-round entertainer. For most of them, it had to remain a dream. But not for this man, not for Freddie Starr.
Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure now, and always has since the age of six, to introduce a good friend of mine, Mick Jagger, who was a very poor boy. His mother couldn't afford a pram, and every time she took him shopping, he used to stick him on the window with his lips. Anyway, I'd like to introduce you now to two good friends of mine, Mr. Mick Jagger and David Bowie. How about that? That's about it for the night. But we'd like to thank Mr. Mick Jagger, David Bowie, and also Johnny Cash, David Struces. So from a friend, from myself, Mr. Elvis Presley, it's good night. God bless you. God go with you. See you again soon.
It doesn't matter what you wear, just as long as you are there. So come on every guy. Grab a girl everywhere around the world.
We will be back in a couple of minutes with more laughter from Kenny Everett, Michael Barrymore, Jim Davidson, and a very special, in fact, a unique piece of comedy from the archives. We'll see you then. Stay where you are.
That bottle. I'll tell you when to touch the bottles. Now, you puny little nobody, we'll begin to make you into a world-famous VG. First, you'll need the world-famous VG teeth. Now you can touch the bottles. Take one pill from bottle A. Not that one. Bottle A, you waste of space. The shirt open to the navel, exposing hairy chest and revealing large golden medallion pill. Or as I call it, bottle B. Ah, he's got the right bottle this time. Well done, little chap. Stage 3, bottle C. You'll be needing the world-famous BG hair. Yes, not bad. But there's something missing. You're only one, and there should be three. Take bottle D. Now you'll need the most important part of a BG, the world-famous vibrato. Will you all pick up the vibrato bottles and keep taking the pills until the required bottle is achieved?
Kenny Everett and the Bee Gees. Kenny, of course, was only the latest in a line of comedians directly descended from the Goons. In fact, comedy and comedians all over the world owe a huge debt to that inspired show. Now, of course, the Goons were only on radio, never seen on television. However, Thames Television, way back in the summer of 1968, managed to get their cameras in to film just one show. And this was the result, or a bit of it anyway. Peter Sellers, Harry Secombe, Spike Milligan, The Goons.
Tales of men's shirts. A story of down under. And I mean that most sincerely.
...1938, but from the continent came ominous rumblings.
Oh, oh, this Spanish food. Oh. Waiter, waiter, waiter. One brandy and pronto.
One brandy and pronto coming up.
How did you know my brandy and pronto were coming up?
Those were the last words said at peace. At that very moment, Germany declared war in all directions.
Bang!
Wasn't worth the journey.
Bang, not worth the journey? War! I must write me memoirs. The day war broke out, Winston said to me,
"This has got to stop, bloody. We can't go on meeting like this, you know."
England is being mobilized.
Recruits were rushing to the recruiting depots at the rate of one a year. We join the story in 1942, a critical year for Britain, with British generals slaving away at their autobiographies.
Across the channel, the German high command were welding a master plan. Oh.
Achtung, gentlemen! Be seated! Our scientists have just invented liquid that will win the war!
Geblunden!
This chemical, when applied to the tail of a military shirt, is tasteless, colorless, and odorless.
Odorless!
The moment the wearer sits down, the heat from his body causes the chemical to explode. This way, the soldier will be neutralized, In more ways than one.
It might be worse than that.
It's eine wunderschön geschriebene.
Speak English, you swine. We can't afford subtitles.
I'm a Yankee Doodle Dan.
Nothing, Yankee Doodle.
How do you get round this thing?
I'm standing sideways. Where are you, Burke? Oh, there he is. Nothing! This is my plan of attack.
It looks like a nail.
No, it's a tack.
Yes. Yes, you're absolutely right. That was John Cleese, looking about 12 years old. Now, let's move up to the present day, to this birthday tribute to the laughter makers on Thames. In a moment, you'll see Michael Barrymore. But before that, I want you to look again at Ron Lucas, the brilliant young American who hosted the Hippodrome show earlier this year and who literally took ventriloquism to new heights.
Lucas, this is scary. Close your eyes if you don't like it. I would if I could. Ron, I don't like this. You don't have as far to fall as I do. If you fall, you'll land on my head. Oh, great, I have something soft to land on. I got butterflies in my stomach. That's not possible. No, it's true, I'm growing caterpillars in my underwear. Is this dangerous? Yes, Billy, it is dangerous. Then why are you bothering me with this? Why don't you use a live child? Billy! Yeah! Why can't we do this with trick photography?
Because we're doing it for a live studio audience.
They can be bought. My mom is down there. Oh, good, you saved yourself $2. What are you doing?
I'll take a step forward. I'm going to salute, and I want you to be real, real still. Can you do that? Okay, don't move. Here we go.
Yeah! Ta-da! Yeah! Can we go now? Ride on horsey! Yee-haw!
Let go of my ear, Billy.
I'm beginning to like this. You know something? The only thing is I'm getting a nosebleed. Billy, that's not possible. You're a puppet. Then sawdust is dripping out of my nostrils. Now what?
Don't move. Don't move. I'm almost at the platform. Let me sit down first.
Yeah. Hang on. Are you down yet? Hang on. Ron?
Yes?
After this stunt, don't you ever call me a dummy again.
Okay. Portable musical center. Portable music center.
Bank it.
Want to bank it? All right, that's yours as well. Okay. All right, whose first name? It's for you, Neil. You must have pressed that. Because that means you should lose that, really. You didn't press it. Did it go on its own? I don't think it did it?
Let me move this.
Hey, sorry? This. Oh, you moved that and your hand slipped and went like that. Yeah. Did you see anything happen there at all, Bruce?
That was Michael Barrymore striking it lucky last Christmas. Now let's have a look at Sid James getting lucky 20 Christmases ago. Carry On Christmas. And the only cracker he was interested in pulling was Barbara Windsor.
Get out of the way.
Shove
it, cut it up the pavement. Go on, get out of the way,
you
Christmas
present. Yeah, Mr. Scrooge. How about a little something for Christmas, then?
That's the best offer I've had today.
That's my only means of support.
Oh, well, you won't need that one, will you?
I'm a nasty bit at work, aren't I? Cratchit! Cratchit! Where's that long, lazy, stupid idiot clerk? Am I? Cratchit! Cratchit!
I'm here, Mr. Scrooge.
I'm going off now.
I thought there was a funny smell.
I'll thump you. I'm going off to bed, you fool.
Oh, Mr. Scrooge. Please, Mr. Scrooge. Things haven't been too good lately, and, well, with it being Christmas, I was wondering, could you make a little advance to me?
Not only long and stupid, but bent to boot.
Please, Mr. Scrooge, think of my poor wife at home waiting for it.
Don't be filthy.
We haven't got a penny piece, and we're having my uncle from Australia for dinner.
Well, what are you complaining about? You'll go down a treat with some onions and a bit of gravy.
Mr. Cratchit?
Yes, that's right.
I say you had got a narrow entrance. Special delivery. Lucky you are. Okay, Joe.
Have a little piece.
Well, I do.
Who are you?
I am the spirit of Christmas present.
You're right. It's the best Christmas present I ever had.
I've been sent here to show you the errors of your ways and all that.
Yeah, never mind my ways. Just keep showing me all that.
So, see, be serious now. Ebenezer Scrooge, I cannot stay long here, so let's get down to business.
A very good idea.
Joe, give over. What do you think I am? No, don't answer that. No, you just sit and behave while I tell you all your faults.
Yeah, well, hurry up, because I'm getting hot under the collar.
Well, there's two things that stick out a mile.
That's what's making me hot under the collar.
No double entendre left unturned. In any history of light entertainment, Hughie Green has certainly earned his place. His long-running series Opportunity Knocks gave us so many stars. And here we see him talking to Tom O'Connor about the show and introducing three of these stars.
Sincerely, Hughie.
Oh, sincerely?
Yes, looking back.
I mean that sincerely,
friend. And friend, we really do. Looking back to the start of Up Knocks, you know, is there anything sort of memorable or satisfying that you can look back on over the years?
Well, I think, Tom, all of the auditions were memorable and all were satisfying, but probably one of the most outstanding ones was an occasion that we were in Cardiff. It was raining, we were in a tin hall, and a little girl sat down and actually fell off the stool. We put her back up on the stool again, and she became, through our show, an international star. And she rose to fame singing something like this.
Those were the days, my friend, we thought they'd never end. We'd sing and dance forever and a day. The life we choose, we fight and never lose. Those were the days, oh yes, those were the days. Die, 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 die.
Thank you. Mary Hopkin, Lena Zavaroni, and the man doing the most extraordinary thing with his muscles was Tony Holland. In 1984, Jim Davidson decided to do a show on location, and the location he chose couldn't have been further away from these Teddington studios. 8,000 miles away in the South Atlantic, the Falklands. So John Mills takes up the story.
After a flight of 13 hours, the Hercules arrives in Port Stanley. Of course, it's raining. Stanley, the first concert venue in the Falklands.
Hi, lads!
Can't believe it, we're here. Magic. See you at the theatre.
Theatre, can you imagine? Hello, Rupert and Wardney.
No, it's just nice to be in this wonderful Port Stanley Hilton. It's magic, isn't it, eh? I'm staying at the five-star hotel, the Upland Goose. Five-star, you can count them through the hole in the roof. No, I'm only joking. I did a funny old sign there. It said, all guests to be in bed before I am. I said, well, what do you mean by that? All guests to be in bed before I am. He said, all guests to be in bed before 1 a.m, you burk. And by the way, just before we get started tonight, have we got any ladies in the audience? Yeah, well, all right, females. Now, if you get women in the audience, it ruins half the act, you see. Well, not really. Well, all we need then is a black policeman to ruin the rest of it. Black policeman. Chalky actually went to join the police force and he didn't like it. They gave him a white helmet. Show people where his head stops and his hat starts. I mean, he was... And you know, some of these young coppers, it's amazing. Hendon Police College, where they're learning, right? They have a conveyor belt and they all come out like as a job lot and they've got a bloke in a white coat checking them. He said, right, switch that one on. Right, he goes, nick, 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 nick. Right, he'll do, Metropolitan Police. Next one, switch him on. Nick, 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 nick. Always a good one, very strong one. Flying squad him. Next one, nick, 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 nick. Reject RAF Police.
Young Jim Davidson down there in the Falklands. And now to a superb actress, a superb comedian, a superb director, and a superb singer. Here is the superb Julia McKenzie.
What I find. happened, I wish I knew. I can't believe that it's happened, and still it's true. I got lost in his arms, and I had to stay. It was dark in his arms, and I lost my way. From the dark came a voice, and it seemed to say,
back in part three with Benny Hill, Bruce Forsyth, Max Bygraves, Des O'Connor, Morecambe and Wise, and more Tommy Cooper. I am so glad I do not have to follow that lot. I'm going to see you in a couple of minutes.
A battleground, because your breath is constantly under attack from drinking, smoking, eating rich food. But we are armed with these new clarets, breath fresheners with actors alter, help neutralize nasty niffs. Of course, Ronnie can freshen your breath by simply removing your head and sticking it in a washing machine.
But clarets are a lot nicer.
Yeah.
Clarets, the breath freshener with actors are.
By opting for easy-to-install electric showers, the resident artists of Acacia Avenue have got all the hot water they need.
Showering electric, setting it free, taking control with electricity.
And at around 3p a head for a four-minute shower, you can afford the odd encore or two.
What language should this man use to talk to overseas customers?
Is anybody there?
It isn't English.
Voulez-vous une pompe solaire?
It isn't French.
Eine Sonnenpumpe Gerät?
It isn't German. Maybe he should try a different language altogether.
Aha!
For this is the business language of the future. And thanks to British Telecom's network, you can speak it anywhere in the world. It can help overseas buyers picture your product instantly. You can even talk direct to those buyers using our online translation facilities.
I think we're in business, Derek.
If we've been talking your language, maybe you should start talking ours. For your action pack, call us free on 0800 800 828. British Telecom. It's you we answer to.
They've eaten all the...
Mini Baby Bell. Mini Real Cheese.
Don't miss it. The Payless DIY sale. Now on all across the country. With quids off all kinds of DIY.
Doesn't look much like the holiday brochure, does it?
Well, there's sun and sand.
Indeed. All the charm and allure of Death Valley.
Ooh.
You all right?
No. Bit run down.
Yeah, your batteries. You fitted those ordinary zinc carbon ones again. I, on the other hand, got myself Kodak Extra Life batteries.
Oh, I'm going.
No, you're not. I'm going. Bye.
You
can't leave me!
I've got all my batteries in the spaceship, too.
Kodak batteries bring extra life to the planet.
Psst, Graham Dean's on Capital Gold. Listen to Graham Dean and great music on Capital Gold. Only the lonely. On 1548 AM, classic hits all day, every day. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off you. Turn on Capital Gold Radio tomorrow, the all-time great music station.
Well, Prime Minister, I can't begin to tell you what an honour it is for me to be here tonight, so I won't.
And I won't shake hands with you. I wouldn't want the rest of your life to be an anti-climax. May I say how wonderful it is for me to be interviewing you this time, so that you can have a chance to speak for a change.
Well, yes, I was going to make
that
point.
Because the last time we met, you hardly got a word in edgeways.
Well, precisely.
And I really do feel that free speech is so important. It is one of the fundamental...
belting up!
Really, there is no call for that sort of mindless yobbery. We're not in the House of Commons now, you know.
Prime Minister, could we please get on with it? I feel a smile coming on. Apart from which, I thought the point of this programme was for me to speak my mind.
Well, that won't take long.
Just get on with it.
Mr. Day.
Sir Robin.
Mr. Day, let's talk about your childhood. Is it true that you were actually born wearing a dicky bow?
No, it was round my neck.
And the lady facing Mike Yarwood's Robin Day was, of course, Mrs. Thatcher doing her celebrated impersonation of Janet Brown. I spend a lot of time in America at the moment filming a series called Equalizer. And do you want to know what the quickest way is to an American's heart? I'll tell you. Tell him you know Benny Hill. The Queen, yes, Princess Diana, Mrs. Thatcher. But if you know Benny Hill, you are in. And I really mean that. Now, with clips from the very first show to the present day, let's have a look at 20 years of Britain's most successful comedy export. Show that has produced more unforgettable heart-stopping moments than any other. It certainly gave me one moment that I will never forget.
Isn't that nice? You should go to Queen, look. I was telling Teddy this is our first film we've ever met.
Hello, Teddy. How are you? I know you're discussing the new series of Callan with Brian Tasmer and Lloyd Shirley, but tonight, Edward Woodward, National Theatre actor, singer, star of Callan.
You're
this
joking.
Is your life.
Where's your camera?
Over there. And as you know, the studio is just across the road.
Because
I thought my family was behaving in the most incredible fashion today. My son even put a tie on.
You know, I do recognise Eamon Andrews, but who was that fellow with him? A skinny bloke, young looking, with the dark hair, you know? Well, come on, it was 20 years ago. Have you noticed how everybody seems to say on that show, you must be joking? I mean, that's what everybody thinks when it happens. You just can't believe it's happening to you. These four certainly couldn't.
From the commissioner's lunch, idiot!
Hey, hold it, Emu! Emu, hold it, Emu! May I please have a little word with Rod? Yes, Rod. Oh, boy. Hello, Hughie.
You can't come in here either.
Yes, I can, because tonight, Rod Hull, this is your life.
Your chance.
I happen to know, and you know, that this is a very special week for Bob Hope, and this is a very special time for him. We want to make this a night that you're going to remember for a long time. Because tonight, Bob Hope, this is your life.
Come on.
Leave your mic up. I know that your voice is being heard by millions of people right now, but I hope they're hearing mine as well. Because if you look behind that television camera, you'll see your executive producer, Derek Mills, who's given me permission to interrupt on air one of the country's best known broadcasters, commentators, television, radio, so that I can say, oh, if I get my breath back on the 19th of April, 1978, at coming up to 6 minutes past nine, Terry Wogan, this is your life.
I wish I'd shaved.
And how an old lady in Nottingham got her ring back. All this and my own...
Thank you. Yes, Guy. I have to tell you, I love the show.
Oh, thank you.
And I thought you might like to join me for a little show of mine entitled Esther Anson, This Is Your Life.
I don't believe it.
Esther Anson there being nabbed by the new man with the big red book, Michael Aspel. You know, there are a handful of entertainers who are known to us all by their Christian names alone. You only have to say Brucey, Dez, or Max, and everybody knows exactly who you mean. So let's meet them now, starting with Max, who is ling-alonging and reminiscing about the year 1954.
And that year, as you can see, I was at the London Palladium in a pantomime. And you notice there was little Julie Andrews on the bill, and in those days, she was a novice. This is before she became the singing nun. And I remember, I used to walk out on the stage, and the opening night, I'll never forget it, I walked out and they said, buttons, buttons! And I looked down and my zip was undone. That year, I did my third command performance, and I was becoming a regular. If I wasn't there, the Queen used to send me a reminder. I'm only joking, Your Majesty. I'm not. And that year, an American singer came over named Billy Daniels, and he was going to things like, that old black magic has me in its spell. That old black magic, that you... Not a good impression, but tomorrow morning, my house will be full of boxes of chocolates. And that year, I was spending a lot of time in America with the Judy Garland show. There's the two of us there doing a couple of swells at the Palace, New York. And when I got back here, a songwriter named Jack Meadows had written a song for me that went like this. When I went to America, I thought it would be wise to dress and act the way the Yankees do. But those wide-awake Americans soon tumbled my disguise. I think somehow they must have had a clue. Did those people know I was a Cockney? When I looked just like a son of Uncle Sam. I walked like Humphrey Bogart, and I clowned like Danny Kaye. I talked like Gary Cooper, and I sang like Johnny Ray.
But everybody knew I was a Cockney. There was just one little thing that let me down. 'Cause when I said, oh blimey, they all knew I was a limey from dear old London town.
This is my dressing room, and we, well, how do we all share it? And I wouldn't have it any other way. It's been like that all day. It's so crowded, so claustrophobic, and so wonderful. But it does come in handy, you know. It's a joke for later on. But it does come in handy knowing you love it when everything goes wrong, don't you? But it's lovely having the girls behind you if you've got a few jokes to do. You know, especially I've got a few jokes to do here, like, there'll be a lot of people in Birmingham tonight. Why? Because they live there. Where's the 48 bus stop? Out here. I'll tell you what, this is better than the script, I'll tell you that. What's the definition of a bottom? Kojak with a party. Keep it going! But enough of this. Feast your eyes on this lot. Follow me. Thanks a lot, darling. Let me just get through. I've never seen such a happy cameraman in my life. Oi, Snowden! Oi, come on me, all right, I'm the star. Thank you so much.
Hello,
hello. Oh, yes, I. At least a corner to myself. Where's the privacy?
Straight down the corridor now.
Oh, thanks. If I can't go, you can't go. Oi! Heel, boy. Heel, Snowden. I said heel. Oh, mirror, mirror on the wall. Who is the fairest of us all? Just my like a glass critic. Well, at least I've got a... At least I've got a hook to myself. A little nail. There we are. Good. Will you get out of my way? My agent's gonna pay for this. I think I'll phone him up.
Imagine me and you, I do, I think about you day and night. It's only right to think about the one you love and hold her tight. So happy together.
If I should call you up, invest a dime, then you say you belong to me and ease my mind. Imagine how the world would be so very fine,
so happy together. Imagine me and you,
you and me,
no matter how they toss the dice,
it had to be,
the only one for me is you,
you for me,
so happy together.
If I should call you up, invest a dime,
and you say you belong to me, that ease my mind.
Imagine how the world could be so very fine,
so happy together.
Yeah.
Tula Clark there with Eric Morecambe's favourite singer. You know, actors simply loved appearing with Morecambe and Wise. I was lucky enough to do their show three times. And it really wasn't like work at all. In fact, I remember saying to Eric one day at rehearsals that I felt like a criminal taking the money. He said, give it to me, sunshine, give it to me. Here they are with one of my favourite routines, the bell ringer.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the show. Tonight it's my... What are you doing?
I'm showing my appreciation of you.
But I haven't done anything.
I know, and I appreciate that. But I've got to be honest.
What?
You're looking very smart tonight.
You think so?
Elegant was the word I was looking for, and your hair,
yeah,
is fantastic.
Thank you.
I said that carpet shampoo would bring it up, and it has, a bit. Absolutely for A.
What?
You would have laughed last night.
Why, what happened?
It's got nothing to do with you.
Oh.
What are the audience like?
Oh, very good audience.
Must have cost Thames a bomb to bail this lot out.
Oh, they're a smashing audience.
Well, it's not me they've come to see, is it?
What do you mean?
Well, you've got to be honest. It's not me. It's you they have come to see.
Really?
After your appearance here tonight, you'll be enshrined in the memories of this audience for the rest of their lives.
Why is that?
Don't ask questions. Do your zip up.
Yeah, what?
Oh,
yes. Oh, it's
Jim. It's Jim. Can I help?
What? That was quite frightening.
Wait a minute, what's this? Surprise! Handbells.
I didn't know you were interested in it.
I've always been interested in it. Then I realised I was getting too old for it, so I've taken this up now.
Are you going to play around?
Not tonight, the wife's here.
I'd like to hear you play those bells.
And so you shall, but keep well back because you are rather small.
Oh, yes.
I could pick you up, shake you, and one or two things might drop off. And if they do, kick them to one side. Dignity at all times.
Oh, dignity, of course. I'd like to hear the bells of St. Mary's.
The bells of St. Mary's?
Yes.
I could break my wrist playing that. The bells of St. Mary's. Yes. For you, I will play it.
Oh, yes.
Yes, what are you going to listen to?
Yeah. I'm looking forward to this.
That's a bell ringer's joke.
Yes, I know. I'm looking forward to this.
Yes?
I'm a tremble with anticipation.
That's a long time since that happened. That grows you up. Right.
Thank you very much.
The bells of St. Mary's. A ding. A ding, ding. Ding, ding.
Ding. Ding.
Oh, wait a minute.
Just a moment, please. Ooh. Ding.
No, hold on.
Who's been messing about with these? You've been messing about with these, haven't you?
Wait a minute.
Ding. That's the one. That goes there.
No,
just
hold
watch it,
hold
that's
it.
All. Watch it. Hold it. Hold it.
Hold it.
Because he's getting annoyed now.
Well,
hold it.
It's a playing act. The bells aren't making a sound. You're doing all the noise with your voice.
Well, of course they are, you fool. Otherwise, you wouldn't recognize the tune, would they?
What are you talking about? You're supposed to go.
He lives in a little dream world of his own. He does.
You're supposed to go. You're supposed to rattle those. You're going. You're going.
Those days have gone.
I know. You're going ding, ding, ding. Ding, 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 aren't you?
Rattle.
Yeah. Don't you realize there's no clappers in those bells?
No clappers,
no
you
clappers.
See.
No. Metal balls.
Ah. Can I help?
You put it down! I told you you'll be a sensation.
This whole thing is a failure.
It's a farce.
You're not doing
the
it.
The whole right. Flaming thing is a farce.
Well, get off.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Do that again. Now the other arm. Now the leg. The other leg. Now the head. Something else.
There's not a lot left to say.
Put them all together.
And what have you got?
One word for Morecambe and Wise, great. You know, they really did break the mold when Eric died, didn't they? But it is one of the great joys of the videotape age that those stars that we love and hold most dear will always be with us. We see them all the time. They'll never die. Stars like Eric Morecambe, Sid James, Eamon Andrews, Tommy Cooper. About an hour and a half and a couple of hundred laughs ago, I promised you more, Tommy. Well, here he is again. And I can't think of a more fitting way to end this celebration of the first 21 years of laughter than with Tommy Cooper.
Spoon Jar Jar Spoon! Spoon Jar Jar! What about that smoking joke? Spoon Jar Jar Spoon, Spoon Jar Jar. Spoon Jar, Spoon Jar Jar Spoon, Spoon. Well, pull it, pull it. Oh, dear. Rose, Rose, I've risen. I don't like it anymore. Look, see that glove? Second hand. Oh, thank you very much. Oh, dear. I backed a horse today, 20 to 1. Should be 20 past 4. He was so late coming in, he had a tiptoe back to the stable. And the jockey kept hitting like that with a whip. Not like that, like that. Like that. And the horse said, "What are you doing that for? There's nobody behind us." I bought a greyhound about a month ago. A friend of mine said, "What are you going to do with it?" I was going to race it. He said, "By the look of it, I think you'd beat it." Dude, my feet are killing me. They're like, every night when I'm lying in bed, they get me around the throat like that, trying to straighten it. My voice sound a bit hoarse. It is slightly, isn't it? I lost it completely in it. The one I got now, I borrowed. For the show tonight. And I went to the doctor, he said to me, open your mouth, so I went like that. And he looked down, he said, a little raw. So I went, So, I went to this doctor. Look at that, I'm leaking. I went to this doctor and I said, it hurts me when I do that. He said, well, don't do it. I was cleaning up the attic last week with the wife. Filthy, dirty, covered in cobwebs. But she's good for the kids. And I found this old violin. This old violin and this painting, all painted. So I took him to an expert and he said to me, what you've got there? He said, you've got a Stradivarius and a Rembrandt. Unfortunately, Stradivarius was a terrible painter. And Rembrandt made rotten violin.
Well, I do hope that you have enjoyed the last 90 minutes as much as I have in the company of these wonderful entertainers. All that remains for me to say is Happy birthday, Thames. And here's to the next 21. God bless you. Keep laughing.